colleagues, can we make a start, please? Welcome to today's budget setting meeting of the Liverpool City Region Combined Authority. Can I assure that people have switched their phones off or onto silent, if at all possible? Just to let everyone know, as we normally do, that this will be broadcast live, and by you being here, you are agreeing to consent to any images or any footage being used in the future. Can you also try to speak as closely as you can to the microphone, towards the microphones, and switch them off after you have spoken, please? And just to highlight that items 5, 6 and 7 contain exempt appendices due to the information relating to financial or business affairs for person. So if we do go on to those, we'll let us know if you want to discuss the content. We'll take some advice from you. Just before I do actually go on to the formal agenda, two quick things. Mayor Anson can't be here. It was his birthday today, or is his birthday today, or can't be here for family reasons, and wish him all the best for his birthday, and also his family member, a quick and speedy recovery. And two, just in the last sort of half an hour whilst we've been preparing for today's meeting, there's a lot of social media attention around halt and transport, and this is something that ourselves as the Combined Authority of Mersey Travel and Holt Council have been working with since it was initially announced that there could be some issues. And all I can tell people, because there's been no formal or legal announcement, is that we are pulling all stops out to do everything that we can as a Combined Authority and as Mersey Travel to secure as many of those services as we possibly can, and Holt and the Council doing what they can to also ensure the same with other partners. Liam, is there anything that you want to add to what I've said?
No, other than I think we're genuinely after a great debt of gratitude to all the officers of the Combined Authority and the whole Council for the efforts they're putting in to make sure that people can still travel around in the next few days.
Anything briefly, Rob?
Yeah, just to say, echo what Liam said, thanks to the officers who have been working tirelessly over the last few days to try and make sure the services. The services are important, obviously, so everybody put the constant stress at the moment on hospitals, colleges, and schools. And hopefully, we can get other services running as soon as possible. Some of the buses that are not running today is because, not that it's ceased, it's just that the drivers have just not come in or they've.
So we are trying desperately to put something in place for start tomorrow. Okay, and it's watch this space for further announcements, of course. And whilst this Halton, of course, as a Combined Authority, there are buses from Halton Transport that go through Knowsley and St Helens and to Liverpool. So that's why it's important for us all to work together to do what we can collectively to ensure that those services, as far as reasonably can be supported, are done so. So, yeah, we're still working, and we will continue to work collectively. Item one is apologies for absence. Trudy?
Thank you, Chair. I've received apologies from Mayor Anderson, Mr. Steve Hammond, Councillor Hardy, and Councillor Robertson Collins. Thank you.
Item two is for members to declare any interest. Item three are the minutes of the previous meeting of the Combined Authority on the 6th of December 2019. Can they be agreed? Any matters arising? No. Item four, therefore, is the Combined Authority budget setting for this year. I'm pleased to confirm that the budget has been considered by our Transport Committee on the 13th and 16th of January, but unfortunately the Overview and Scrutiny Committee was in court, so it was unable to consider the same budget proposals. But as we look forward to the budget for the next year, I am nearing the end of my first term in office, and I'd like to take a moment to reflect on some of the things that we've been able to achieve in such a short time, really. But when I first stood for the position, I promised that there would be no borough left behind. And when you take a step back and look at what we've delivered to date, especially in the face, it has to be said, of government austerity, I think we can proudly say that that promise has been kept. For instance, we've delivered more than £400 million worth of investment right across the city region. We've created 9,000 jobs and 5,500 apprenticeships, again, in all of those of our six boroughs. We opened the first new station on the Mersey Rail network in a generation just last year. We launched the UK's first UCAS-style apprenticeship portal, putting all the information onto one site so that it's much more simple for those people who want to take up apprenticeship opportunities to look at those. And to support that, we brought forward plans when we introduced the apprenticeship travel card, which is half price travel on buses and on rail for those apprentices going through training. And we're the first combined authority in the whole country to be recognised as a real living wage employer, and I'm showing that we set standards and hope that others will follow, but we're also working to develop a fair employment charter to encourage businesses to pay workers a decent wage, offer them good terms and conditions, and real opportunities for training. And we all know that if you treat workers better, then productivity increases, so it's not rocket science. And we're taking measures to revitalise our town centres, not only giving each of the local authorities the ability for £1 million to develop master plans, but also with things like £15 million for Kirby Town Centre, up to £15 million, which will help to purchase and regenerate what we call in Kirby the townie. So that's really good news, because far too long the private sector have let people in Kirby down. And together we've painstakingly built the foundations for a fairer, more just and more prosperous city region. And I can talk about foundations because as a former bricklayer, it's important to get the foundations right, and that's what we build on, and hopefully in the future, that's what counts, which brings me then to today's budget. And I've always said that I'm proud of so much of our city region's past, but really excited about what lies ahead of us. And last week we welcomed the first of our brand new £460 million worth of rolling stock, the first publicly owned, when I say publicly owned, they're owned by us, not just us in this room, everybody in the 1.6 million people across the city region. We're the first to own our own trains, and that for me is symbolic of what we want to do with a bright future and what we need to do on our transport network, and that is to build a London-style integrated transport system that really is fit for the 21st century across the whole city region, and to ensure that that's complemented by a daily fare cap using smart technology. So we've got our metro cards now, which again, hopefully people all know. And there's no reason that we should settle for any less. London, 30 odd years, has had public subsidy on their transport system, which is £419 more than we get in our city region. And if people believe that we should stand back and allow our people to be treated as second-class citizens, then that's not what I was elected as the Metro Mayor for. I simply won't do it. Not good enough for us. And the government have been made aware on a whole series of occasions why they need to provide us with a fair transport support funded package. And our brand new trains will be at the heart of what we're trying to do. You know, with buses, our 600 kilometres of walking and cycling route, and trying to put all together to get a transport system that's quick, reliable, and affordable. And one that prioritises passengers, not shareholders. So these steps to improve our transport system will also be crucial. crucial to the much wider issue, which is the existential threat of climate change and climate emergency. And as people will know, we declared a climate emergency last year. We were the first in the country authority to do that. We also got a very ambitious target, which we believe 100% we can reach either on or before 2040. But that will mean that we are in the best position to capitalise on the green industrial revolution. I think there's going to be tens of thousands of jobs, and we want as many of them as possible to come to the Liverpool City region. And all of that is supplemented by what we're doing ourselves to decarbonise and to look at innovative and transformational projects. So the amazing title, Power Project, is going to be key to what we do to take that forward, as well as providing enough sustainable energy to power 20 million homes. It will create thousands of local jobs, not just in construction though, but also in science and research and development. And make our city region a worldwide centre of excellence in a key industry of the future. And that, along with hydrogen, photovoltaic, which Rob's going to make some announcements soon on, offshore wind, and that tidal project, we can become Britain's renewable energy coast, and we really start to see the benefits of that. So all of that said, what does it actually mean, and what does it look like to the budget? So to help us with that, John Fogarty is going to take us through the report, and then we'll open up for any questions. John?
Thank you, Matt. Members, first and foremost, right beginning, this is a, as presented, it's a legal and a balanced budget. Beyond that, it is, as you've heard, a budget for delivery, focused very much on that. And in the first, the key decisions that bring up the budget around the Mayoral element of the budget and the CA's broader budget for its operational cost, this is reflected, this focus on delivery. So, as you've heard, the budget allows for a very significant investment in our ability to manage the extremely large and complex suite of projects that are on our agenda. But it's not just capital projects anymore. Housing First, Households into Work, and the £50 million adult education budget are all really significant services in their own right. And looking ahead, we need to be in a good place to receive further funding from government. We need to invest in a pipeline of developments so we've got projects that are good to go as funding opportunities arise. And the Mayor has done this using external funding wherever we can. And this has meant that the Mayor has been able to shield local taxpayers wherever possible. As a result, the Mayoral precept, which was introduced last year, will be frozen at its current level, which is around £12 to £14 per year for a typical household in the city region. Second of the key decisions relates to transport, and the Transport Committee met last week, considered the requirements for transport, and they're recommending a 2.1% increase in the transport levy for next year. This is an inflation-only increase, and it does represent the first such increase in almost a decade. Members will note, importantly, that this does not apply in Halton, who continue to have separate arrangements for transport funding within the overall CA family, and those arrangements are also reflected in this report. Payments to bus operators make up the largest proportion of the transport levy, and the Bus Services Act gives them significant powers over the bus network. And this budget includes provision for investigating the best ways to use the MERS powers. Smart ticketing is also provided for, which will be a very important element of this agenda within the budget, alongside a significant investment to our Transport Cities Fund, cycling and walking provision. Third of the key decisions relates to Mersey Tunnels, and again the Mayor and the Transport Committee are proposing no change to the current schedule for 2020-21, and this will allow our residents to continue to benefit from the £1 local fast tax. In terms of our capital programme, there are a number of very significant projects, as you've heard, underway, and foremost amongst these is the rolling stock project. And it is appropriate that the first of the new fleet of trains has already arrived and is in Kirkdale Depot at the moment. Changes to network rail infrastructure are required, however, to realise the full benefit of the new fleet. And this report also contains recommendations related to capital financing and that will accommodate these changes. So that is a very brief overview of what's a very significant budget. and I'm happy to answer any questions the Combined Authority may have.
So Robson, do you just want to add anything before we go to any questions?
Yeah, I certainly will do. So maybe some of those points about the transport network, particularly the Transport Committee met on the 16th of January and warmly endorsed both the tunnel toll recommendations and also the transport budget recommendations. If I may, very briefly, with regard to tunnel tolls, I think we're always very conscious of just how critical those assets are to life in the city region. They're very expensive assets to maintain and to operate, but we're also very conscious of the fact that whilst we get no central government funding, we have to have a tolling regime in order to pay for those. But we equally understand the cost of living challenges that people have locally, so we're very sort of pleased to be able to bring forward no changes in the tunnel tolls for the year ahead, and particularly protect the £1 fast tag that certainly was a mayoral priority that we've introduced. Equally, very pleased to support what we think is a very good, balanced and solid transport budget for the year ahead, very much not only protecting frontline services, but very much focusing on introducing some of those very exciting steps forward on the transport network that have already been mentioned. The brand new fleet of trains, as John rightfully can't highlight, the first one is in the region. The little homily I'd tell is I went to see the first train arrive at 1 o'clock last Thursday morning, and what told me that we're doing something really well here is when at 1 o'clock in the morning in Kirkdale, 30 train spotters were hanging over a bridge taking pictures. If you get in the train spotter community so excited, you know you're doing something brilliant on the rail network. And obviously this budget will allow us to kind of roll out the introduction of that fleet over the year ahead. Equally enhancing the rail network, kind of a mention made about things that we've already done, the Hull North and Halton Curve, but crucially the year ahead will give us the ability to deliver brand new lifts at 5 stations, very much focused on the upgrades at Prescott Station for Shakespeare of the North. And very much we hear loud and clear about Headbolt Lane being the next brand new station on the Mersey Rail network, and we are picking up your gauntlet, Steve, that this will need to be the fastest delivered brand new station anywhere in the country. Equally, the budget gives us the opportunity to invest in the long-term future of the Mersey Ferry, something that's vital to life in the city region, something that's vital to the transport network, and that gives us the ability to invest in the long-term future and the landing stages. And the final point that I wanted to make is that over a number of years, because of austerity, it's been difficult, but we have been able to protect large parts of our bus network. Every part of the city region still does have access to the bus network in a way that most other comparable city regions don't. But I think forefront of all of our minds today with the emerging situation that we're finding in Holland is that absolutely for too many parts of our region the bus network is not working as well as it should do. And it's absolutely right that we are investigating devolved powers and looking at the different opportunities of how we can change the bus network so it does deliver for every part of the city region. And I'm very, very pleased that at the next meeting in February we will be bringing forward those proposals, and this budget allows us to do that.
Excellent. Any questions? Can we then ask Jill to talk us through what is A to S, or needs to be voted on in slightly different ways?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. You have a number of recommendations for you, as Mr. Mayor has outlined, A to S. We'll take some of those recommendations individually, some of them grouped together, if I may. So recommendation A, that the report be noted. Is that agreed? Recommendation B, that the mayoral budget is presented at table 2 of the report. Is that agreed? Recommendation C, the agreed to freeze the mayoral preset at its 2018-19 level equivalent to £19 a year for the band D property and £12.67 per year for a band A property. Is that agreed? I'm going to just jump around and ask if you would look at recommendations E and G. So recommendation E is the approval of a transport levy of £97.4 million for the years 2020 to 2021, based on the appropriate index of inflation, RPI, at November 18, 2019 of 2.1%. And if I may ask you to also consider recommendation G, accept that the recommendation of the Liverpool City Region Combined Authority's Transport Committee in respect of tunnel tolls, which is at table 10 of this report. Are they agreed? So noting that Holster have abstained, Mr. Mayor, the rest of the recommendations, which are recommendation D, recommendation F, and then recommendations H through to S, Mr. Mayor, if they can be taken together, if members are consent to adopt that approach, they can be agreed en bloc.
Great, can we move on then to item 5, which is the City Region Digital Connectivity Programme. And this is the phase 1, which is called Dig Once, part of the Digital Connectivity Programme. And Councillor Baines is going to take us through the report.
Thank you, Chair. Modern industry needs modern technology, whether it's a logistics company delivering home shopping orders, a creative SME producing video content, or a precision engineer fulfilling global supply chain orders. They all need great connectivity. Future development, like 5G networks, self-driving cars, and personalised health, all rely on high-capacity fiber networks. Currently, fiber connectivity in the Liverpool City region is not good enough. Your 2017 manifesto, Chair, set out to address that. This project allows us to install fibre infrastructure every time we take on roadworks, cycleways, or other street improvements. It saves time, saves money, and saves disruption. The infrastructure that we develop here will go towards a city region backhaul network aimed at improving connectivity in every borough. We're currently searching for a partner to invest in this network alongside us. The network will help our existing businesses grow, and it will improve our appeal to new investors. I've asked the team to consider how the network can help us also provide better public services. Finally, and importantly, for those of us working to improve our town centres, and I'm totally committed to the Liberal plans to improve ours in St Helens and Earlstown, digital connectivity can play a supporting role, and indeed in the future it will play a central role. Chair, this project offers a strong benefit cost ratio, and I recommend it on this basis.
Any questions? Okay, can we agree the recommendations as set out on page 63 of the report, please? Item 6 is the provision of grant support to the Civic Data Co-operative. It's £5,280,000. Councillor Hackett is going to take us through this report.
Thanks, Chair. This is a project by Liverpool Health Partners and the University of Liverpool. Request just over £5 million to support the creation of a civic data cooperative. The initiative, Chair, will bring together health and social care data to help improve health outcomes across the city and region. Chair, we have to try new ways, of course, to keep our residents healthy and happy, and we have to try enough to close the health gap in our most needy areas. In my own patch, it's about raising health life expectancy for the good people of East Wirral. This is another example, Chair, of the Liverpool City Region leading the country with a bottom-up approach rather than top-down sale of people's data. As we have all agreed, Chair, we must handle people's data, must be not very carefully. This project will normalise all data, retain ownership of all data, and scrutinise companies before they access the data, and create citizens' juries for how data can be used. Chair, I recommend this project as a leading example, of course, of inclusive growth with the potential to attract new enterprise to our city region. Thank you, Chair.
Excellent. Any questions for... can we agree the recommendations set out on page 97 in the report, please?
Agreed.
7 then is we're being asked to approve the provision of grant funding for the SIF Strategic Investment Fund of up to £2,050,000 to support the remediation and infrastructure for the first phase of housing development on the mosque new site, which will come, I'm sure, as really good news to the people in St Helens, especially Councillor Baines. But Councillor Hackett, you're going to take us through the report.
Thanks, Chair. this is great news. This project requests £2 million for the remediation, as you rightly said, of the former coalfield site in St Helens, about 2 miles southeast of the town centre. The site has lain dormant, of course, for many years, and we're pleased to be seeing it return to life. Chair, property developer, the Harwood Group, needs the funds to clear the lagoon, forgive me if the pronunciation is wrong, the lagoon, if I'm right, from the site and install, I'm sure people can explain what that is, and install infrastructure for future housing. Apparently, the lagoon is a chemical leftover, I believe, from the site's industrial past and must be cleared before anything can happen, obviously. Harwood Group will provide, Chair, £7.5 million for the project. This SIP intervention will lead to the development of 240 new jobs, new homes, and new projects. The site can accommodate for at least 680 units over time. Chair, the project itself offers high value for money, as usual, and will require a strong overage clause to recycle funding. Given the strong competition, Chair, for projects, it's absolutely vital that we focus on recycling funds where we can. Finally, Chair, can I recommend this project? Thank you.
Thanks, Pat. Any questions for Pat? Of course, David. Just a comment, just to thank you, Pat, for bringing this forward. This is, as I said, great news for St Helens. It's another example of the city region doing great work for the borough and the whole city region. Regenerating brownfield sites and providing new quality housing on them is a priority for me. It's a priority for St Helens, and I'm delighted this significant funding, if approved, will allow us to start delivering this on an important site that's been vacant for far too long. It'll also bring improved sports facilities in the local area, drive further investment and regeneration. This is good news all around, and I'm delighted to support it.
Excellent. And we always get you, we get asked as leaders and as the mayor, and I'm sure Joe gets to say, why don't we use some of the brownfield sites? This is exactly that. And it doesn't matter what it's called, it's taking the nasties out so that it becomes commercially viable to build those properties. And that's exactly what this remediation pot does. And this is the first phase. I'm sure we'll see further expansion in the future as well. So good news for everybody, certainly the approach. Can we agree the recommendations are set out on page 149 of the report? 8 then is the pinch point bid to the Department for Transport. And Councillor Robinson is going to take us through this.
Yeah, very simplistically. The Department for Transport launched a national pinch point fund of £150 million. For across the country that local authorities can bid into to deal with challenges on the highway network, particularly focusing on sustainable transport challenges. For those local authorities within combined authority areas, the criteria is that the bids need to be submitted via combined authorities. So as per the report, all 6 of our local authorities have put forward a candidate scheme, and in line with the criteria for the bidding and also local priorities, we prioritise them, getting my teeth there, in the right order accordingly, putting those forward to government.
Any questions for Liam? Okay, can we agree the recommendations on page 179, please? 9 is, of course, the existential threat that I mentioned earlier. You'll recall that I announced at the Environment Conference the creation of a climate partnership. And this report provides an update on the developments of that partnership. And an updated report has also been circulated, which proposes additional membership to that partnership. So, Councillor Powell, you're going to take us through that part.
Thanks, Mr. Mayor. The creation of the Liverpool City Region Climate Partnership will provide a step change in our response to the climate and ecological emergency. It will provide a high-value forum to bring together experts and citizens to co-create responses to the pressing challenges created by climate change. The partnership builds on the 2019 Year of Environment Programme. And I would like to thank Vivian Bentorgan, who sat behind me, the Mayoral Advisor for Environment, for all his hard work during the 2019 programme. We are delighted also that Vivian has agreed to act as chair of the Climate Partnership. The Climate Preliminary and the partnership will act as a forum where the as a source of views, insights and opinions can be gathered. Partners will work with the Combined Authority on the LCR Environment Fund. The fund will play a critical role in supporting grassroots initiatives, transforming local environments across the city region.
And it fits nicely, dovetails nicely into remember the young person that we had coming and speaking to us and passionately talking about saving the planet. We need to do our bit. We can't save the whole planet, but certainly we can contribute to what we need to do as a city region and, of course, to the country, and then to wider lobbying for others to follow suit. I'm also delighted, like you, Rob, that Gideon has decided to become the chair. Gideon has done unbelievably fantastic work over the last 12 months, the year of the environment, culminating in that great summit that we had. And I don't know, Gideon, do you want to add anything to tell us some of the things that we can expect?
Well, I think at this stage, Chair, I'd just like to thank very much the privilege of being asked to chair this body. It's going to be very, very important for the city region. We hope that it will help play a key role in developing the climate action plan for the city region. And we hope, as well as establishing the board, that the chairing will be this wider panel or forum involving a whole range of voices across the city region. So at the end of the year, 2020, we hope there really will be a very robust action plan for the city region, which has been consulted with, contributed to very, very widely across the city region. So we look forward to working very much with colleagues around the room and many partners outside to do our very best to support the city region in this crucial challenge that we're all facing.
And members are part, you know, the partnership itself, the members come from a very broad range of backgrounds, but specifically we've got young people on that, and I'm sure they will be, should be pivotal to pushing us as politicians. They challenge us, and we are doing something about it. So, yeah, we look forward to what the outcomes of that partnership are with you. Can we therefore agree the recommendations on page 187, please? Item 10 is just a bit of housekeeping, really. It's a notification that's been received from St Helens Council that Councillor Joe Pearson is to replace Councillor Paul Pritchard on the Transport Committee. And we just need to agree those recommendations on page 193. Is that agreed? 11 is the draft committee timetable. And literally, it's the timetable for 2020 to 2021. It's on page 195. Can we agree that? We truly haven't received any public questions.
No, Chair.
And no petitions or statements.
No.
So the meeting of the Combined Authority, the next one, will take place on Friday the 28th February 2020 at 1 o'clock, and with that said,